Hello, friends. My name is Rob Gowing. I'm one of the pastors here at Antrim Brethren in Christ Church, and it's my pleasure to welcome you today to our seventh week of quarantined live stream service. It's a different world, but we are so grateful that we are able to come to you this way and that you have welcomed us into wherever you are to join us today as well. We are just looking forward to God's special blessing today on all of us as we've come to worship Him. Lord willing, we'll be back here next week the same way. So do stay tuned and invite your friends to join us as well. We want you to be very aware that our staff team is still very much in place here at Antrim. We are all available to you, and we would love to hear from you. You are free to call in, to use social media to contact us. Likely the best way, though, is through our website. If you go to www.antrimbic.net, you will come to our website. There, if you scroll down just a little bit, you will find two buttons. One says, "How can we pray for you?" And we would love to know how we can pray for you, so feel free to leave us your requests there. The other button says, "Stay connected." And on that button, you can do all kinds of things, including leaving us messages. We would so love to hear from you. Where are you listening from? What state? Is this the first time you've joined us? Has the service blessed you? We would really love to hear from you, so please do get in touch with us through our website, and we will trust that God will be a real blessing to you today as you worship with us now. As we go to worship, let's all sing together that wonderful song of worship, "The Goodness of God."
Running after me. Sunday with your families today. So I have a question for you this morning. Can you see the wind? No, you cannot see the wind, but you can see the wind when it's working. You can see the trees blowing and shrubs swaying back and forth in the wind. Now my next question is, can you see God? No, we cannot see God, but we can see God at work. God is unseen, but his work is very active in our daily lives. So, I have a term I'd like you to think about this week, and the term is God whispers. What I want you to do is look for little things throughout your week that whisper how much God loves you. And I want you to focus on things that God has created. So you are going to look for things and listen for things that God has created that whisper his love to you. And I want to give you an example. Behind me, I have some beautiful shrubs and they are called privet. And just a few weeks ago, these leaves were not here on this tree. This shrub was completely empty. And I enjoyed looking at the little buds on it for a few days, and each day the buds would start to open a little more and open a little more, and now this entire shrub is filled with beautiful leaves. And then, here again in June, there will be little white flowers that will start to grow on this shrub, and it will smell beautiful, and it will be covered with bees, which are great to have in our backyards. So, this is one of my God whispers that I see in my yard, and I get to watch it change throughout the season. So I want you to look for God whispers and talk about them with your family. And as you're doing this, I want you to remember Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. When we take the time to be still and listen and look for those tiny whispers, you will see God at work in your life, even in the smallest things. Go and have a great week, friends, and I hope to see all of you soon.
Good morning. It's great to be with you all again. And once again, we'd like just to remind you that we are so looking forward to the times that we can be back together here in the church building. Today, our prayer focus is a little bit different, but we would also like for you to consider praying this week for the leadership, not only in our government, but also here in our church staff, as the decisions are being made to be careful and loving towards our neighbors at this time of uncertainty, as well as wisdom in when to open things back up within the economy and our church doors. So if you would pray with me now. Father, we are grateful that you have provided a way for your word to still go forth, even amidst an uncertain time where we're not able to gather together and have the assembly that you have asked us not to forsake. So, Father, I pray that that will actually take place in our homes, that we will be assembling together there, that we will be able to recognize our neighbors as part of a community that we could still be reaching out to and being the church for. Lord, I pray that at this time, we as Americans will just understand the difference between freedom of religion under human law and the spiritual freedom in Christ that we have, Lord. I pray that we as Christians will not render their spiritual freedom to the government, but to God alone. Lord, I pray that we will understand that our true security lies in you and not in a political system or structure. And yet, Father, we are so grateful to know that we live in a country that has provided religious freedoms for us through the blood that has been shed by brave men and women who have defended this land. But Father, I just pray that that does not overshadow the blood that you have shed that has given us true spiritual freedom in your name. Lord, I pray that we also as Christians will remember that the church building is not where your glory dwells, but yet, Lord, you have created with your church, your New Testament church, a temple in each one of our bodies to house your spirit. So, Father, I just pray that we will live as though we are that temple, that we will concentrate on being holy because you are holy. Father, even Solomon, when he built the first temple for you, he knew it could not contain your glory. And so, Father, I just pray that we also will live in such a way that will reflect your spirit to those around us. Lord, I pray that you will guide us and encourage us to live boldly in this capacity. I pray, Father, that we will know and remember the promises that you've made to us to produce endurance, character, and hope in the hearts of your people. We praise you for that. And Lord, we also ask you to increase our awareness of these gifts by your hand during this uncertain time. Lord, I pray for discernment for our leaders. I pray for them in the government positions that they will be considerate of the people around us who are infected with the virus or who may become infected with it, and that they will consider those things as well as giving them discernment for when to open up businesses and the church building even for large gatherings. Father, I pray for our staff here that they will also have the discernment of when to take the right steps in order to open up our assembly once again. Lord, we know that you are in charge of all things. You are sovereign over all things. And so I pray that we will trust in you to lead and guide us, to give us all wisdom. We thank you for the promise, Lord, that you have given to us, that you will give it to all men liberally who ask. And so, Lord, we ask you today for wisdom. Father, we thank you for the time that you have given us together just now. And we pray, Lord, that though we are not receiving your tithes and offerings here in this building today, that you will still use the generous tithes and offerings that are coming in to support your mission. And Father, I pray that we are faithful to continue that mission within our homes today. We ask all these things in your holy name, Lord. Amen. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. If you would now join us in song as we worship the Lord with Be Still, My Soul.
Well, good morning. It's good to come to you here this morning as we continue in worship. Wherever worship is for you, it's a pleasure to be able to come to you and to worship you in spirit, even if we're all not in person. As Rob said earlier, while we can't believe this has already been 7 weeks, in some ways we're getting a routine, and in other ways, I don't think we could ever quite get used to addressing an empty room. So it's empty. We miss you guys and ladies. We look forward to whenever it is that we will be back together. It's a pleasure to come to you today as I share a few words God's put on my heart from Psalm 46, as Allison just read for us. It's a great psalm I know is close to many people's hearts. And when I first began here at Antrim about 3 years ago, I had an office with blank, empty walls. And behind my desk was a 14-foot empty swatch of painted drywall that clearly needed something. And I thought, well, we definitely need to spruce that up. We need that to be a bit more homey, make it look a bit more pastoral. I didn't have a lot of time, and I had even less interest in doing that or figuring out what should be on that wall. So I spoke to some of the decorating gurus here at Antrim, some ladies, and they came through and really helped me out. And part of their decorating scheme for my office included this one section where it actually has the words, "Be still and know that I am God." And at the time, I thought, that's appropriate. I like that psalm. That was a good choice. You know, that looks appropriate. It looks pastoral. It looks like something a pastor of congregational care might have on his wall. Little did I know in a few short years what a ridiculous understatement that would be, that knowing how to be still and being in the heart of God, it's not appropriate. That's the lifeblood of what he calls us to be. So anyhow, the psalm that we've just heard read, again, it's close to many of our hearts. As you face trials or hardships or maybe an illness, surgery, often the fear of the unknown is where that type of comfort can come out. To be still and know that I am God. There's so much comfort in that. It's also one of those classic lines in Scripture. We all have them. We all know them. We all have Scripture memorized that we can go to when we ourselves need an encouragement. We need a dose of truth, or we can share it with another person. How great when deep truth is summed up well in a short quotable form. But as is the case with most lines of Scripture, when we do that, sometimes when we lift that out of its larger passage, we lose a little something. We lose a little of the depth, a little bit of the context. And I doubt this one's any different. So let's start again at that beloved line, to be still. Most of us probably rightfully, you know, see that as some form of not worrying, of being able to step back, to be peaceful, to not be overwhelmed, to be consumed. I remember for a long time when I would imagine, well, what does it mean to be still for me? What does that mean? To be in the presence of God and to know stillness. And, you know, I probably thought of something maybe you have. I imagine like a clearing in a forest. You know, maybe the sun is shining through. There's not a wisp of wind. There's not a threat of danger. It's calm. It's peaceful. It's inspirational. There's not a care in the world. Not only is there no problems, they've been lifted up and they've been set off of me. Not a care in the world. I've made it. Peace is mine. And I think a surface reading of that scripture probably supports that. You no longer have a care in the world. There might be elements of truth to that, except for one thing. This psalm is not about complete and utter peace, at least peace in the way where there's no problems. In fact, it's not about a fight being over. This psalm is all about the fight, just that it's not our fight. It doesn't mean we're magically transported to a place where we're not affected by hardship, or we don't have things like cancer, or financial stresses, or sickness, or anxiety about the upheaval of coronavirus. No, this is all about fighting, just not you and just not me fighting. It's all about God battling, realizing you have a champion, a warrior king who goes out before you and conquers and faces the very real suffering, the very real threats that are in the world. Martin Luther knew this. This was his favorite psalm. He reportedly wrote, "Let's sing the 46th psalm, and let the devil do his worst." And then he went out and wrote, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." The title of that gets lifted out of this psalm. So again, there's very real battles. There are very real injustices in this life, very real suffering. God has never said, "Get over it. Forget your pain. Be quiet. It's not that bad." It's never been about him making us deny our needs, our experiences, those things that threaten to overwhelm us. It's just all about him. the one who is completely qualified and able to take care of those things, who fights on our behalf. So a slightly deeper reading here might be still and let God fight for you. Hopefully, as we'll see, an even deeper reading says it was never your battle to begin with. There's many components, of course, to how a person can be still, what it means to have peace. So today, though, I'd like to focus a little less on how you can know stillness and peace, and maybe focus a bit more on that part that gets in the way for most of us, the fight, which so often blocks the stillness, which blocks our peace. Maybe we can unpack it a little bit. Well, this psalm is all about the fight, as I've said, and turmoil. And you can't miss it. It's all about calamity. It's full of natural disaster and war and the threat of war and all the experiences that come with that. And it bookends the whole thing. Verse 1 says God is our refuge and strength. On the bottom end, verse 11, it says the God of Jacob is our fortress. These are words of power and military might, and they were intended to get our attention in that way. And it gets right to it. By verse 2, we're reading about natural calamity, about the earth crumbling, about earthquakes, about mountains falling apart and falling into the sea, about roaring rivers that foam. I should say roaring oceans and tidal waves that foam, the elements of water that overcome us. Later in verse 6, it keeps it going, but this time it's the nations that are raging. It's all that people can do. Wars, it's about kingdoms rising and falling, and you imagine huge empires raging against each other, east to west, left to right, and all the instability that can come with that. So we have here represented some of the worst that nature and human beings can throw at us, which is to say, it can be pretty bad. The psalm here is not really about natural calamity. It's not a treatise on the place of war. What it's saying is the author is trying to get our attention that there is no short of calamity. It's universal, it's human, it hems us in. If it hasn't happened already, it will. It'll affect us on the macro scale, it'll affect us on the micro scale in our very hearts. There's no shortage of suffering in this life, just to make that clear. But it's all about the warrior God, his omnipotence, and his power, and his reign. Twice we're thrown into this calamity, you know, in which he matches the crisis with equal measure of his own strength. Twice there's this great crescendo as it grows up at the very peak each time, God overcomes or he redeems the threat and uses it for his own purposes. The earth falling apart there back in verses 2 and 3, he reminds us that he is the Lord over natural elements. But then in verse 4, it suddenly switches gears in a major way to this river, a picture of this peaceful, flowing, nourishing river, water. The same element that was just roaring and foaming and threatening to destroy all that we know, here, God has completely redeemed it for his own purposes, for the nourishment of his holy city, for his church, for us. And then it switches back again. Of course, verse 6, we're back at war. The nations again, they're fighting, they're raging. No earthly kingdom is untouchable. I think that's one of the things we're supposed to hear in that. This time, God leaves nothing up to imagination. Verse 9, he fights for us, and it's a definitive victory. He not only matches blow for blow what war and evil can do, at the very peak of that crescendo, he says, no contest. He shatters the elements of making war itself, the bow, the spear, and he ends war. It's a definitive victory. It's done. Just in case somehow we missed it, unless we begin to think that somehow we accomplished these feats or maybe even that somehow we were co-partners in the will of God being played out, it switches gears in another big way. Up this point, it's been third person, describing things, descriptions of events. But now God, this warrior God, turns his focuses on us directly, the hearers of this, and he speaks to us in the first person, and we're addressed personally. He doesn't say, praise my name. He doesn't say, cheer. He doesn't say, I want to hear your verbalization. I want to hear your voices praising my name. No, he says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The victory is mine and mine alone. I'll go before you. Perhaps God would go on. I will not be deterred in my plans. Evil and suffering and calamity, I know of these things. I know they're very real, and I know they're heavy weights for you, and I know they threaten to overwhelm you, but it does not mean that I'm not aware. These things have a season. The outcome is already secure. Even if the battle is still petering out in some ways and you're not completely immune to the effects of suffering in this life, be still And I don't say that to you as a correction, not as a reprimand, but only because I know what you so earnestly need. My earlier vision there of this tranquil clearing in the forest where all the problems are gone, yeah, I think that's an incomplete vision. God isn't saying the problems or struggles are wiped away in the blink of an eye, and perhaps a better vision would be the same forest, the same clearing. But now there's a hut, you know, a thatch-roofed hut just latched together, and a hurricane blows over. My forest is near the sea, bear with me, but a hurricane blows over. It's not just gale force winds. It's the loudest, most ridiculously absurd, horrifying, terrifying thing anyone could ever hear. And you're inside that hut. Your five senses are overwhelmed. It's threatening to blow in from all sides. This absurd, ridiculous hut. There's no way even God can protect me from this, is what would go through every single one of our minds. But yet somehow through that, we're saved. We're not quite sure how. We're taken to the brink of being defeated, to be destroyed. But God is in the midst of us. His peace is there. This psalm is all about stopping our fight and taking refuge in the God of Jacob, our fortress. Finding nourishment in that river whose streams make glad the city of God. That is stillness. Let's look a little bit closer at the fight. First, quite frankly, God delights in fighting for us. At its core, letting God fight for you, this is not an abstract spiritual exercise. This is not him wondering if we'll pass this test at its core, because he's given us all that we need. We should just kind of buck ourselves up, pull up our bootstraps, and go about it. He's going to see, though, how we'll respond. It's not that at all. God delights in being our provider. God delights in fighting for us. He desires to fight and to provide all that we need because he's available. He is dependable when the world is not. We have several examples from Jesus himself. Again, some are so well known to us. Matthew 6, where he says, you know, look at the birds of the air. They don't reap. They don't sow. Your Father in heaven provides all that they need. He feeds them. Look at the grass. Look at the flowers. Look at the splendor out in the meadow. You know, they're here for just a short time, and then tomorrow they're going to get mowed down. They're going to get bound up. They're going to be burned. If God can create that beauty, how much more does he want to do for you? You who he loves so much. So seek the first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, not these things. God knows these things. And that's true. It's not about a matter of ability. It's his heart. Because we're his created beings. We're the only being that God put his image in. If he will do all these things for lower order beings, he cares about them deeply, but birds, grass, plants, he cares about those things deeply, but his image is in us. If he provides for the natural realm, what will he withhold from us? Nothing. In Luke, we're given that same parallel passage, the same teaching, but this time, you know, Luke captures an extra detail Matthew didn't. He actually ends his passage with, "Fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Little flock. It indicates a softness in his heart for us, a gentleness, kind of really captures that pastoral, that shepherd quality. He cares about the things that overwhelms us. He cares about our heart as well as these things. It's the Father's good desire to do it for us. Because at its heart, God's desire is not about providing material resources. It's always been about him lifting the internal weight of life off of us, of freeing us from anxiety and worry and being overwhelmed. You know, Jesus, again, he said another well-known passage. Come to me. You have heavy hearts. You're labored. You're heavy laden. I'll give you rest. This yoke that I put on your shoulders, it's light. It's nothing. I'm ultimately the one carrying it for you. What I do ask of you, I'm going to give you the ability to do anyway. You who are lowly in heart, come to me. I'll give you rest for your souls. None of us would argue with a flood. We wouldn't fight with a storm. We know not to rationalize with an earthquake, and I'm assuming most of us would never knowingly take on the forces of Satan by ourselves. But sometimes we need to acknowledge, though, that we're beaten. And head for refuge. God delights in being that refuge. Two. Again, I really don't think God here is saying, be still, stop your fighting, as some kind of spiritual test. So often we're kind of primed to think God's testing us. It's not that we're fully capable of solving our problems. He's just wondering if we have the inner strength to trust. No, the truth is, we can't. We're finite. We're human. We're mortal. We simply don't have enough for any of this. We not only lack physical strength, when we run to the end of ourselves, if we're not careful, we tend to backfill that with anxiety and worry. Other things that can come out of that: runaway fear, depression, worry, anxiety, and the difficulty with turning off our thoughts, whether it's because of a major issue in life, or whether it's a more deep-seated struggle you carry for long periods of life. For a lot of us, that's a very real battle. By some measures, up to 20% of the population have struggles with anxiety and fear. It's not as easy to switch it off in our own strength. Our tendency to worry strikes at the very heart of what we worship and treasure, however. The things we worry about themselves, they're not necessarily bad. Every one of us, we want stability. You know, we want strength. We want reassurance. We need encouragement that God is with us. But Christ himself, he wants to be those things. Worry and anxiety in us seeking to fill those things with something other than him. And it actually grieves him. Not because he's selfish, not that he has some arbitrary high standards, but it grieves him because he knows that he alone can truly meet all of these needs. His command to seek first the kingdom addresses our tendency to pivot away from him. It's a very real problem, actually, but I also think it's one of deep compassion for us as children. Perhaps it's less of a jealous God demanding allegiance than a loving Father who knows what we are and what we are not capable of. And there's a lot we could say about worry. Fortunately, we're blessed. We have rich scripture. We have resources in the church and outside of the church. We have ministries set up to seek, to encourage, to build up folks and people that have struggles with that, because worry can be complex. It's probably good to add here that we should all keep in mind that worry and anxiety, these can be multifaceted. They're complex. You know, for some of us, again, these aren't things we can just flip off. You know, it could be deep-seated. We could struggle with these things due to some early life experience. Some of us even have a genetic or a physical predisposition to struggling with that. It's complex, and we should keep that in mind for ourselves as well as others we know that worry with these things. To tell someone who worries with anxiety, just don't worry about it. Trust me, they want to do that. That's the one thing they would like to do. But the good news is, this is not a death sentence. This isn't a chronic illness. These are things, yes, that God can address. But there are a few other things that account, I think, for worry in us, and that's suffering and sin. Tim Lane is a Christian author and counselor, and he told a story of when he was preparing to go on an international speaking engagement about one of his new books. And as the trip drew closer and closer, he found that he was getting more and more anxious, so much so that on the day before he left for London, he bent over to put his socks on, and his entire lower back seized up. Any little movement made it worse. So bad, he actually had to go to a doctor to get injections to free him from that. The littlest movement here had completely sidelined this man. How ironic that the worry was about traveling to speak about his latest book entitled Living Without Worry, How to Replace Anxiety with Peace. After some reflection, he said there were a few things combining to create this in him: suffering and sin. Suffering. There was very real suffering. In this particular case, again, he is a finite human being. As he prepared for the trip, probably ran into some physical exhaustion, as you can imagine, getting ready to go on a trip around the world. Real suffering took hold. Not imagined, not in his head, but very real suffering. He came to the end of himself, but he didn't heed the warnings, just as every one of us has experienced this at some point in time or another. It's universal. Suffering is real. Often worry is connected to a very real experience or threat, and God knows this. He's concerned about that. Jesus himself devoted big chunks of his ministry to healing the sick, to alleviating suffering, sometimes before or even in place of teaching. God takes suffering very seriously, and it contributes to our human experience of anxiety. And then there's the sin. Well, after Tim alleviated his symptoms, he began to do some deeper soul searching, asking himself questions, trying to figure out what brought on his anxiety. Tim discovered that a lot of his anxiety was driven by a fear of what others were going to think about him. How would audiences receive him? Would his material seem up to par? Would he appear successful? Would he look the part? And then, of course, the snowballing effect of worry took hold. That, too, is something every one of us can relate to. What was happening was he began to revolve his life around another kingdom, not God's. He was enamored with his fame and much less with God's. Even the things he, and I think often us, worry about. They're not always sinful. They're not in and of themselves bad. Will we have enough money? Will this chemo treatment do what the doctors say it will? Have I prepared enough? Have we taken all the precautions to not get this virus? These things themselves aren't necessarily bad, but we all know the power they have when we assume to be the answer for them, when we assume to find all the evidence to provide for them, to take responsibility for them. And before we know it, we are consumed with ourselves, with our abilities, with our strength, and not with God's kingdom. The message here is not so much don't worry as it is God saying, let me worry. Come to me. Tell me. Hang it on me. Yell at me. I know it's hard, but trust me, when I say I can see ahead, I can see all things. I can shoulder what you were never intended to. Every problem has its solution. It's my place to provide it. And again, let's not have too much of a low view of the God of Jacob here. I don't know if you'd notice that when it refers to God in the psalm, it calls him the God of Jacob. Why is that? He didn't say God of Abraham. You know, Abraham, who was told to be faithful, that would have been appropriate. Not God of Israel, you know, the God of the nation, that might have made sense too. You know, he said, God of Jacob, take refuge in the God of Jacob. Jacob means deceiver. So basically what God is telling us here is take refuge in the God of the deceiver. Jacob was a conniver. He was a swindler. He cheated his brother out of a rightful inheritance. Then he spent big chunks of the rest of his own life conniving to get ahead, conning other people. Jacob, who God later used to father the tribes of Israel, Jacob was later reformed and molded and grew in righteousness, and he was used by God. But God didn't do any of those things. He didn't found the nation, so to speak, on the back of Jacob because he possessed something worthy. He had some strength. God didn't say, oh, there's my man. There's a person that's trying hard enough. There's some strength. Yeah, I'll build my people out of that. No. God used him in spite of that, in spite of his wickedness, in spite of his sin, in spite of his imperfections. God chose him, and it was his good pleasure to use him. And it's same with us. God does not look at us and say, that one's worthy to fight for. I'll be his champion. No. God both works in us, for us, and through us because it is his good pleasure, because he loves us, because we are his children. 3. There's other things about the fight that concerns God. Not only, again, is he the one that delights, not only is he the one that ultimately has all we need, but I think also God also knows the fight's not good for us. He wants to protect us from ourselves. We're not talking here about being just tired or used or spent up. We're talking about when we fight from a stressed posture, one where we're defensive, fight for our life, our backs up against the wall, that brings out the worst in us. That brings out things like pride and anger and fear and depression. We find ourselves further from God, not more dependent on him. A few months back, before all the social isolation crept up, I caught a movie in an actual theater. You remember movie theaters, you know, where you got in your car and you drove to a public place and you bought food from someone not wearing a mask or gloves, and then you sat elbow to elbow with strangers and you thought nothing of it. Those were some good days, weren't they? So when I did that last hurrah in the theater, I saw the movie 1917. It was about World War I. It follows some British soldiers in France. Very well done, I thought. In this particular story, it picks up, you learn that the British are getting ready to mount a major offensive. They're going to assault the German lines the next day. Well, the night before, just hours before, it's determined they had some bad intelligence. The German position is very fortified. It's going to be a bloodbath. High command says we need to call this off. So as the story turns out, and since it's Hollywood, of course, the only way to get the message to the general at the front is to two grunt soldiers that they send behind enemy lines. So these two guys are sent out with this message. So on the way, Lance Corporal Schofield, who has the message, he's warned about the general he will be reporting to. He says, when you deliver the message, make sure you have witnesses, because some men just love the fight. Here's an official order that no doubt will save the lives of thousands. And he's cautioned that that general might ignore it. Why is that? Because when you feel built for war, not warring feels like cowardice or uselessness or idleness. And for some people, that's worse than the fight itself, to feel helpless, like I'm not doing something when I could be. Is that what's going on here? Do we think we know better than God? Do we think that we could fight better than him? No, most of us surely would not say that. But our hearts and our minds and our spirits, I think sometimes that's precisely what's going on. Even if it's a battle we know we can't win, we struggle to relinquish the control of our lives. When I say fight here, I don't necessarily mean a good form of fight. Once again, the example of cancer. If I have an illness like that, and I say, hey, how's it going today? And you say, you know, I'm doing well. I've got a lot of fight. I'm really taking this thing head on. No, what you're probably mean is, hey, I've got attitude. I've got a good attitude. I'm trying. I'm conjuring up the strength I have. I'm working with my doctor's treatment plan. Yeah, the good things. No, what I mean here is when we retreat, just like those soldiers in that particular time period, to a trench, fighting not with faith or scripture, not with a heart of worship, but with our response to pain, back against the wall mentality, and again, it only breeds anger and pride and more pain. Sometimes this is played out quite literally in this way in marriages. We can fight for a lot of things when in reality we're making a preemptive strike to avoid being hurt. That happens a lot in marriage, dramatically so. There's a lot of explanations as to what could go wrong in a marriage, but a common denominator, probably to all of them, is the place of pain and how that pain is or isn't addressed over time. Nothing destroys a good relationship like pain. Things even like infidelity or disrespect or neglect in a marriage, those don't necessarily in and of themselves in the relationship. What destroys them is the pain and perhaps the disregard of that pain by the people in the relationship over time. Conflict like this often is cyclical. You know, people do things, say things, withhold things, push buttons in their spouse, stick the knife in and twist it because they know that'll land a punch. Often in the moment, that feels powerful. That feels like we went on the offensive. But in reality, it's clearly defensive. It's hoping we won't be hit with a salvo, the return fire, and again feel wounded or vulnerable. That's what a lot of our human fights are. It's actually fighting out of a defensive posture and out of a fear. God wants to protect us from that fear, and he wants to protect us from ourselves. 4. Just as that general in the movie felt built for war, standing down when every fiber of his being said it was weakness, we also hear be still and think it refers to conceding the fight. We can anyway. We can feel like we're quitting spiritually. The reality is that being still does not mean we lack power. As we've seen, we can continue to fight. We can continue to try. We do have certain reserves of strength. They'll be used up, but we can try. However, it says keeping a hypervigilance. Once again, that's just going to bury us with things that we can't lift off our shoulders. It's really more like power deferred. We do have power. You know, if I'm sick, I realize again that it's his fight. But God is never asking me again, if I have cancer, he's not saying, pray to me, keep your head down. You're to only expect a supernatural healing. We're not expected to go use any of our God-given brains or abilities to get information. God's not saying anything like that. No. Would we not prayerfully consider what our doctors say? Would we not investigate specialists? Would we not read up on treatments? Would we not go talk to someone else who's had the same diagnosis to hear their experience? Of course we would. This is not removing the human element. We continue to work. We plan. We just don't hang everything on our ability to plan because, once again, if I said it once, I said it a million times, the battle is his. Finally, he will be exalted in us. There will be a victory. Verse 10. When we're told to be still, we're told to have it and have confidence because it's he who will be exalted. It's he who will be raised up. It's he who will be exalted before the nations. That's a bold promise. We have to admit, of course, it's also a future promise. God will win. His ways will prevail. His outcome was not in question. However, it's also true that his desired endpoint may look very different from our own. And I think if we're honest, this is probably one of the most difficult things about deferring fights of this type in life to God. We know the outcome we would like, and it's quite possible that God may have something else in mind, and it makes us fear. We might fear more pain. We might fear failure, embarrassment, or even worse. And this is definitely where faith is submission. Because no, quite frankly, Scripture's clear. No, it doesn't say, you know, turn to me. God doesn't say, you know, come to me and I will make your path straight and I also will fulfill every desire of your heart. I will fulfill your bidding. No, of course, we know God doesn't say that. Because right now we have a partial knowledge. But there is a coming future, bold, victorious restoration and a goodness and a wholeness. We have a lot of promises about this. Again, some we know so well. God will work all things together for the good of those who love him. If God is for us, who can be against us? Romans 8:28. Proverbs 3, in all your ways submit to him and he will make your paths straight. He didn't say, I will answer all your prayers in the way that you so desire, but I will make your path straight eternally. That'll be even better. Now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Because now I know in part, but then I'll know fully. John saw the future in Revelation 21. John heard, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. And there'll be no more tears or mourning or crying or pain anymore. Why? Because I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, and I've said so. That's our promise. We serve a God that not only sees the future, he's outside of time. He's completely self-sufficient. He has all power. What's more, he's good, and he keeps his promises. Of course, he often does not see fit to fill us in on his ways, but those ways, they can be trusted. There's no better thing in all the universe to trust than all-powerful God who's also good. In other words, no, he's not going to shield us from the effects of every painful experience. Suffering is an ever-present part of being a human being. But we should know that trouble can't come into a person's life without us permitting. He will equip the afflicted. Satan can throw all he has at us. But at the end of the day, God is your strength. The risen Lord reigns. And that victory? Because I don't think being still is the climax of this psalm. I think being still, really, that's our present response to who he is. The psalm is about God's victory. But that victory is not even verse 9, where he's shattering bows and spears and he's putting an end to war. You might think so. To us, that sounds like the climax of power and authority. No, I think it's best described by that river. Back in verse 4, the river whose streams make glad the city of God. God is in the midst of her, and she shall not be moved. God's saying, hold on. Wait until you see what I have in store. Don't fight now for what you think is best. Hold on to me. Leave it to me because I promise it doesn't even begin to compare to me, to that future place, to the nourishment I have in store for you. In Ezekiel 47, that's another place where we're given a great picture of this city of God that's being nourished by this river. In Ezekiel's vision, the river is flowing out of the temple from God himself. And it says, all along the banks of this river, all the way down, there are trees growing, fruit for food for the nations, and the leaves are for the healing of nations. And when that river hits the sea, it makes that salty, brackish water sweet, life-giving, fresh. All tremendous pictures of symbolism of the life-giving flow from God himself. We're invited to share in that life-giving water now. Jesus gave the call. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me. Whoever believes in me, out of his heart also will flow rivers of living water. And this is where there's our promise for today. Yes, a lot of this is future tense, no doubt. But again, there's also a promise here for the here and now. To be still and be nourished by the river, that's God's Holy Spirit now. He's doing this now. Drink from him daily, that's prayer. Retreat and find a place to hear from him daily. We all have ample opportunity to do that right now. Are we doing that? Speak to him with expectation. Expect him to move. Be still, expecting him to work. This isn't us always being idle, not the way we think of idle as being unbusy. We're actively going before the throne, before the Lord himself. Do it with expectation, because he will. He also will assure you that you're loved. He will speak to you promises from your word. So read it, know it, study it. See if he doesn't provide just what you need each and every day. Being still is not taking ourselves out of the fight. Being still is letting God go before us. Let's pray. Almighty God, God of Jacob, you who not only, Lord, have all power, but choose, Lord, to bestow goodness and mercy, grace, peace, and joy on your people, we praise you and thank you that though the world, Lord, is overwhelmed by troubles, Lord, we threaten to be overwhelmed as well. We thank you that we have these promises that, Lord Jesus, if we're still, Lord, you're here. You meet with us. You go before us. Just pray, Lord, that you would, where needed, pick up some of this pain, suffering, and, Lord, just the strive, the need to fight, to battle that some of us carry. Give us the ability, Lord, to lift that off, to let you lift that off. Praying, Lord, that you not nor just will fight, but you will provide. You will overcome. You will fulfill all those things that we are painfully aware that we lack. Thank you, Lord, that with our surrounding climate and context and the world we live in, Lord, these are very real and relevant promises. And we hold you to your word, Lord, trusting that your power and your goodness will prevail. We pray all this through the power of your Son, Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
A mighty fortress is our guide, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flight of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. And on earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength? strength can fight. Our striving would be losing.
Hey, it's good to be with you here today. As we go out, often at the end of a service or even in the benediction, we're often looking for, expecting to hear something on the lines of go and do. Today's not about go and do, it's about know and be. There's no secret formula to unlocking the peace of God, to inviting His Spirit into our life. As believers or followers of Christ, if that's who we have these things. It's not so much that we don't have it, it's just as much as we can grow in that. Seek Him, follow Him, ask Him to work to completion in your life what He has already began. Again, it's been great to be with you. Have a great week. We miss all of you. We look forward to being together. Let's pray for each other and just hold each other up here as we're apart. Thanks. Go in peace. Our striving.